tu tahi tau whakanau ngā mihi kua mihia ki waho i te mai ātea. Kia koutou kua haramani ki te whakamana i tēnei kaupapa a rakatira mō tātou i tēnei wiki. Tau tōkana ngā mihi ki ngā tīni aitua ngā pate kua pākea tātou. Ka huri aku mahara ki kia rātou ako mai a mātau i te wā mātau i kone i te whare wānanga a Matt Tahau a Bruce Springsteen. Tai nō ki tēnei tamāhina a Esther Davis e tīraha tonu mai i o rākei mā i tēnei wā. Nani kouta ka mate haere ki te hokioki, kia noho whare ki koutou o mātau a i o tītukai. Nā reira, a ko te poto e nei kōru kia koutou, haere hokioki tai mai. Nā reira, kei te mai a tea, a tu matoenga, e hora nei, takahia koe ngā manuhiri o te mutu, tai ngō ki tēnei rā, e hora, e hora. Tāne nui ana. E te pū he nihoni, he te pū he rea rea, he te pū he katea katea ki rongi ki a koe, i ho matua koe. Hau tina, hau tina, hau taki taki te pū ngā kenga kenga o tā wānanga, o tāne nui ana. Ko koe tēna e kaui nei tēnei kaupapa i tēnei rā. Nā reira tāne nui ana. Tāne te waio, tāne te oroka, tāne te matua, tāne te wana, tēnei mātou, auiri, e noho nei i tō puku i tēnei wā. Nā reira tū tonu koe, hei pare pare mō ngā tauira, o ti rā mō ngā iwi kato o te mutu. Pai te whare e tū, tū. Pai te whae tapu, nā rangatina. Ni au ni kia kōtau, e whakatū nei tēnei āhuatau. Pai te mihi au kia koutou katoa, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou. Nā te rō ngā kōrero i te pōhiri, mā koe wai atu kia mela ki te whakamāramatu kia e kia āhuatau te pōhiri. E rangi kei te tautoko ngā kōrero kō whakapua kēnā mai i te marae, e pāna ki enei rangi tēnei wā. Nā reira koutou. Tēnā koutou. Kei konei au ki te kōro ki a tātou o tirā i wāinga nui a tātou e pāna ki tēnei kaupapa e kia nei ko te kaupapa Māori. Ma kōro rau mō te kaupapa Māori mō ona āhuata. E rangi ko te me nui ko ona painga e whakamana ai tātou i te Māori. Ona painga e whakamana mātou ranga mā. Nā reira, tēnā koutou ngā kai rangahau, ko tai mai i tēnei rangi ki tēnei hui. E rangi ka tipu te pātai kei roti au nei. Hea te kaupapa ka rangahaua ai e koutou inai nei i tēnei wā. He kaupapa whakamana mātou rangamā, he whakamana e kaupapa mō wai. Mō te kāwanatanga. Mō te whare wānanga nei, mō wai, mō te rā kamupene, a mō tātou kē pēr. Tōnā te tino pātai tuatai. Mena ka rangahau koutou mō te kāwanatanga, e ki tonu o rātou kapata i ngā rangahau kuatia tātai. Ngā kōrero a Maharae Uniata, a Pēr Hohepa, a Bruce Biggs, a rātou, te rāma, taino ki a koutou i tēnei wā, ki ama ngā kāpata, i ngā kōrero, ko oti a tātai. Ngā kōrero whakatako te huarai, kia kitai te kāwanatanga, kia maramai, ngā tino wawata o tātou te iwi mā. Kei he ngā hua. Kei he ngā hua e nā mai. Nā reira, tēnā tātou katoa. Ko te me
ma. Tanta ma. Kai te olo tonu te whakatai whenua tanga o te kawara tanga ki a tātou. Ka tāmi tonu tātou i a kaupapa i a rā i a wiki. Ka tāmi, tāmi a e te premia, e ngā minita. Kāre koutou e ki, ki te atia koutou e omu ki te tango pene, ki te tuhi kōrero, whakahe e ngā kōrero. Nā rira mehe mehe kairanga au. Tū mai koutou, puta mai ki te tautoko i tō tātou tikanga, i tō tātou ora. Kaua e waihoa mō ngā mema paremata ki te kōrero pēnā e pāna ki a tātou. Ngā kōrero whakahē i ngā rūmaki reo mahi i roti ngā kura. Ngā kōrero e pāna ki te āhua o te pohi. E whakawehe wehe ngā tāne me ngā wahi i āna kōrero. Āhua roa. I hea koutou i te rawa, kārawi kiti o koutou tuhi tuhina. Ko tahi ana ki te wahine okona i tēne whare wāna i tuhi tuhi kōrero. A kia rātou e pāna ki tēne. Nā te mea, ka pānui he te pākehā te Newpepa, ka whakarongo ki te reo inirangi, ka whakapuna rātou ki ona te kōrero e pāna ki a tātou. Ai, tino o te pōhiri. Kona te kōrero puta mai a purepura. Oi, te tahirangi, haere au ki te pōhiri, e rima haura te roa. E harap tēnā te kōrero tautoko i a tātou. Ki mai a Dauba, kāre he he i āna kōrero a mea e pāne ki te pōhi. Nā rīra, wera tapu wero ki a tātou i te tīmatatanga. Kaua e noho wangu, mena ka ki te koutou i te tahi mea pānuhia kāre koutou e whakai. Rongo koutou ki e tahi kōrero tāmi Māori. Tū mai koe, whakahoki kōrero ki a rātou. Whakakoringe e nā teka. Kai whakapunana te iwi Pākehā. Ai, kore take te iwi Māori. Nā rīra, he tīmatatanga tēnei mō taku kōrero. Salutations as well. We've been talking about Kaupapa Māori theory, Kaupapa Māori initiatives. For 20 years, so let's just take check of what we are talking about. What are we actually doing? What are our goals? And are they relevant to whom? Who decides what research projects you embark on? Is your research based on who will pay you? Put your hands up on that. Are you a researcher who has certain skills that are for sale? Is your current research project a passion of yours, or just a job someone wants done? I'm picking on you. You are a unique group of people. I've kore take au I tēnei mai. Does your research fit into the real world? And if so, whose real world? New Zealand's, the world's, or the Māori people's? Do you think your research is kaupapa Māori research? And if so, why do you think that? Do you follow some sort of kaupapa Māori research procedure, step one, step two, step three? Yeah. Or do you karaki at the beginning and then think Māori while you're working? If you find my opening remarks somewhat flippant, then I sort of apologize. But I have read some kaupapa Māori works which I find far removed from the interventions that we noted when we first introduced kura kaupapa, kaupapa Māori kura to the world in the 80s. Even then, when we coined that name, kura kaupapa Māori, we realized that kaupapa Māori was indeed a notion in its own right, which could apply to a variety of situations in the Māori world. So just briefly today, I'd like to just revisit the notion of kaupapa Māori as an intervention into the education system and see if those characteristics which we identified still apply. For our kura kaupapa Māori, basically the crudest definition of them is adhere to the Māori philosophy called te aho matua, based on Maori knowledge, use of Maori pedagogy, whānau ownership, whānau control, and total immersion Maori language learning. That's the crudest definition you'll get, but it's still quite accurate. Kaupapa Maori, in terms of kura, though, was an intervention into Maori failure in the public school system. Let's not forget that. And how was it an intervention? And that's what I want to talk to you about and to see if these things are still relevant. The first intervention was tino rangatiratanga, or self-determination. Kuru Kaupapa Māori was a Māori initiative. Māori did it. By Māori, for Māori. It was created outside of the formal government programs at some hardship to kohanga whānau. And many of you here are part of those whānau, those pioneers who bravely kept your kids out of school and did it. Commitment hardship, it incorporates Māori aspiration and to save and promote Māori language and culture. Therefore, it was attractive to Māori. So it has our own tino rangatiratanga. No one else did this, we did it. Does your research do that? Emancipatory, it consists a Māori model to exist outside of a state system which was failing us. For years and years, for generations, this government system has failed us. You know, you hear them say, oh, it's the mother's fault or the parents' fault, the kids are failing. Hikama, those schools failed our parents too. You know, it's about knowing what to do at school and knowing what to teach your kid or tell your kid in order to succeed at school. Who likes going to a place that failed you? So, you know, it's emancipatory. Kura was ours. Yes, fresh start. Let's go. Visionary, the third intervention. It promises a Maori future, and by golly, we're seeing some of that now. It certainly promises still a Maori future. It is visionary. Validation of Maori knowledge. Well, you know that. The whole teaching and learning styles, Maori knowledge is totally validated. The Maori way, everything, from reo to tikanga. E tangihanga, ka haere katoa te kura. E tangi e tamarai, ka haere te kura ki te poroporake, ki te mana, ki te whānau, ko pani. E ramai, totally validation of Maori knowledge. Karekia te tuatahi. Maori pedagogy. Did you know that word? The use of Maori cultural notions, devices, and philosophies in learning situations. Our way. Making learning a natural process in accord with Maori living patterns. In particular, Maori pedagogy centers on the whānau concept and the myriad of reciprocal relationships within whānau members, which whānau members are embraced. It's really simple, and we live these ways in our homes, on our marae, and so on. So it was totally user-friendly in our kura to use Maori pedagogy. The next one I consider to be one of the most important, kawa. The etiquette of the kura is totally from within Maori cultural values. The whole outlook of the kids at the school, the whole outlook of the teachers, the whole etiquette of living there every day is very, very Māori. Karakia I ngā atakato. You know, in this country, we celebrate Easter. We give you 2 days off, plus the weekend. It's 4 days. You jump on your car, take your new boat to the sea, get too many mussels, and have a good time. And we celebrate Easter. What is Easter? The Aranga, the great. But we're not allowed to say prayers in school. State schools don't allow karakia to be the rule in their school. So I'm just telling you, in our kawa, karakia, pōhiri, mihi mihi, whānau, tuakanataina, tautoko, all these things, Māori. our cover of the kura is so natural for our children. We are preparing them for two lives, the life in the far world, but also as Māori, fully equipped. Some of these children know about kawemate. Why kawemate? Not just the, they know the customs and that. We take our kura out to some hui, or so do you. And it's interesting that often the kids know what to do, whereas a lot of our adults still don't know what to do on the marae. But they also know the reason why we do it, which is beautiful. So how does your research measure up? Oh, whānau is the most important one of these interventions. Remember the old days when you went along to the fourth form school meeting and hid in the corner because your dress was broken? Or something, or frightened Mr. Smith is going to ask you a question. Mr. Smith, that's not a funny one. Sorry, Grant. Mr. Higginbottom. Frightened Mr. Higginbottom is going to ask you a curly one, and you might stutter, or you might get the wrong answer. And so you never went. Or one of the Māori parents went amongst all the pākehā, or something like that. Well, look at kura. Katoa mai ngā parents, haere ki te hui whānau, whawhai ana for control. They all think they own the school. Ora taku koe ki te whakaaro taku tamaiti, and away they go and into it. Well, we've never owned something like this before. It is so beautiful to watch. A complete turnaround. The government doesn't even recognise that. So whānau is a very, not only the whānau support, but the kuras of whānau. Show me a kura kaupapa where someone is called sir. Papa he, Papa Peter, Fire, Koka, Uene ngā ingoa. And they're not just names, they are roles. So some nights they go home with kids in tow. Because the parents were late and they can't be bothered waiting around to take the kid with them. And the kid just moves in, does the dishes, watches TV. Mother turns up, sorry, you didn't get the kura at the road of market or something. But it doesn't matter. Whānau tātou. And it's a beautiful whānau. It's a totally accepted behaviour to whip someone else's kid away. Pono. My moho is swimming on Wednesdays. I put his dog in his tail. He keeps losing his tail. I said, look out for those dogs and tail. Off he went to kura. I went to a meeting, come back to the marae, and I looked over in the kura. Ha! His mate's wearing his stomps. Dogs are kura. And he's got his, what do you call those? Boxers, yeah. He's got his boxers on, playing on the swings, and his mate's got his swimming togs on. So that's how they live. This is a whānau. A whānau tēnei. So how does your research measure up to these characteristics? You see, I've got a hidden agenda in coming here today. I happen to believe that Kaupapa Māori provides us with a formula for intervention into the many of the situations, the institutions, and the practices which serve to subordinate our people within New Zealand lifestyle and keep them trapped in the dependency cycle. I believe that Kaupapa Māori is an intervention. It is my view that Kaupapa Māori versions of various community services would not only achieve service delivery, but would emancipate and empower Māori to take a leading role pursuing Māori aspirations. It is so very, very important that we not survive, but we survive well and we create in this living. We don't want to be living dummies. Our people want to be happy, healthy, wealthy, and, well, not quite wealthy, but a bit wealthy. Accordingly, I subscribe to the view that Māori researchers should be proactive in researching those opportunities, those possibilities that would create change for Māori. Because no one else is going to do it. It's like a lot of things. People say, oh, I can't do that. But if you don't do it, who's going to do it? The lady next to you? Honest. And this applies to all of us. You are not a small person. Everyone in this room has got not only the courage, but the ability to tell Mallard a few things about his score and stuff. And to tell your own MPs, get out from under the petticoats. Have a life. There's a life outside of the petticoats. because no one else is going to do it. It's bad enough that some research is being ignored. The point is, we Maori are an endangered species. You know, they march to save the whales, the tree, a 100-year-old building, all those things, and let the Maori mate. In fact, they can try and kill us with their programs and so on. We have survived the marginalization and schooling of the 19th century, where we weren't allowed to do maths and physics and stuff, kept on all the dumb subjects. The Tohunga Suppression Act, we survived. You know, they had our own people laughing at our tohunga. The effect of the Tohunga Suppression Act was to make them look like gully boys. Our own people laughed in the 1910, in that time, at the tohunga. Their mana was completely destroyed. Imagine that, the carriers of your knowledge. In today's time, that's like all the priests and ministers, all the teachers, all the professors, all the nurse doctors, all the top whatevers, gone. We know best. And that's the equivalent of what the Tohunga Suppression Act did. But it did more than that. It made a laughing stock of them. How can we value Maori knowledge if that's been done to our mothers, our fathers? So we've survived that. We've survived the public beatings for speaking Maori language in the first part of the 20th century. That's what happened to my mother. Here it goes again. And again. And again. Go e kōrero Maori. Don't speak Maori in this school. Takapo Brun. You hit someone, they get a message. So I grew up in Takapo, ka tō mai mātou ngā tamariki, kōrero Pāhea. E pat our parents, kōrero Māori ki a rātawaru. I grew up hearing Māori all the time. All my aunties walking down the street, we could pick up the odd word, like broken pants or something key like that. Chocolate one in it too. By their rule. Colonization is happening all the time. Sometimes we have to say no to the Bhutia. Don't do that to us, government. But this is the kaupapa that still is carrying on. When we fought to have kura kaupapa Māori recognized as a bona fide kura tai. In and out. We got legislated for in December 1989. In January 1990, we were called to Wellington, seven schools, to get our money, Which meant we didn't have to fundraise for salaries and all that kind of stuff, and we were going to get an establishment grant and all those things that you get. Until then, we've been borrowing paper from other schools, we've been doing this and doing that, giving teachers the honour of making their own shelves and sweeping their own floor, giving them real empowerment, writing their own books, you know, whiting out the pākehā words and putting in Māori words. We really empowered our teachers. And so suddenly we're going to Wellington to get the Māori, and we all met down there, and we were seven schools, yeah, me, tata, yeah, tata, and in come the education ministry. Prum, 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 down the passage. Prum, prum, open the door. Prum, prum. Yorodu. Well, congratulations. You are now a bona fide kura. And we welcome you here. We know that there's seven of you. So we've decided we're going to fund six of you. And we looked. We couldn't believe what we were hearing. Yes, we've got funding for seven schools this year. So we'll leave you to sort out the six. Prum, 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 prum. We couldn't believe it. We looked at each other, we couldn't believe it. I wonder if we were another race, another ethnic group, what we would have done. But let me tell you what we did, because we were Māori. Tū mai a rua mata o te aroa. Kei te pai, tēnā koutou, ngā kura. Tēnā rō mātou i hai. Kei te pai mātou mō tēnei tau. Me tū mātou ki rau. We will stand down from funding. You six have it, we'll join in the next round. So, up jumps another school. No, you've been going too long. You are important for Te Aro. We're one of the Auckland schools. We'll stand down and we'll wait. Another school, we'll stand down. I thought, I better get in here. Yola Tato, we'll stand down. And they go, no, you're the Matua school. You've got to stay. Okay. They finally convinced me, yeah, I better take the money. Anyway, what happened? What happened was, when they came back, the ministry said, yeah, you're funding these six schools. Rua Mata wasn't on the list. But what did three of us do? We gave a quarter of our money to Rua Mata. See, we have our own tikanga. We have our own way of solving things. They were not going to do that to us. So that's how we dealt with that. And then when Rua Mata came on, they got their own money, and we kept their own. Now, just to tell you that, we are different. And we've got to, if we don't fight now to preserve our identity in the belief that we have something to offer New Zealand, not to be Maori fossils, not to keep our culture because we are, you know, but because we actually believe in mana ki tangata, ngā kau māhat, bohin. We believe that these are good things. You know, in this city, there are people, Pākehā, who are now putting their bodies in their living room, clearing out the furniture, and ringing us up to go along and help them, advise them, how do we do it? And we say, well, your sister kaupapa, and it's beautiful. We do this. We usually keep the food separate. Oh, okay. But you don't have to have speeches, you can just let them come in. The main thing is mana ki tēnei and each other and go together to bury the person at the end. Oh, time after time after time we are encountering this in our communities. They got it from you. They got it from nowhere else. They didn't get it out of a book. They didn't get it from this government. They got it from you. And you are giving some beautiful things to Aotearoa New Zealand. And that's why we have to take it to a better place. We have to pursue kaupapa Māori because of its own value, not because we want it. So that we can share this with New Zealand. And half the problem why they are fighting us is they don't understand our customs. Perhaps it's time to open the door and share our values so that they can understand that the poor feeding is not the length of time you sit there. It is not a welcome ceremony at all. It is in fact a tapu lifting ceremony. It is in fact a relationship between the living and the dead. It is in fact a relationship between hunakai and manuhiri. Nothing to do with a welcome in the sense of pākehā. And so on. I forgot I had a speech here. I'm only up to page 6. Well, you first hold me up. So after 200 years of colonization, Māori still want to be Māori, and that's the point. And now we have a situation where both major political parties, Oritiana, they're hell-bent on negating Māori initiatives, on denying tamata whenua status to Māori, on redefining tikanga Māori to suit Western cultural values, and more. The language has survived the first wave of extinction with the resurgence led by Kohanga and Kura, but is now under threat more than ever, our language. Don't believe we're safe. We're miles from safety. Until our kids can stand up and talk about Haley's comment in Māori about the government system and stuff like that, we've got to get into the hōhonu kōrero. I firmly believe that Māori research organisations, such as the one promoting this, which I belong to, which is beautiful, but the organisations need to wānanga with Māori entrepreneur, with Māori in the fields of justice, social reform, education, economics and health. And then on their own initiative, create or research into the possibilities to create change, to promote Māori excellence and development, even survival in some cases. So I'm asking the organisations themselves to be proactive. Do your bread and butter stuff, and with what you accumulate, actually initiate research, which, I don't know what you call that, applied research, that's a good term, APP, I'm not kidding. Māori researchers are possibly one of the most potent tools for change for Māori. That is, kaupapa Māori research into Māori alternatives to a one-size-fits-all is what we've got in New Zealand. Kaupapa Māori research into alternatives to that system could take New Zealand forward, I believe. I'm not going to stand here before you and list the disadvantages of our people today. You just got to read the paper. Because you know how we fare in health, wealth, prisons, crime, education, housing, whatever. We are a bubbling economic enterprise for New Zealand government. Māori social dislocation is a major industry in New Zealand, employing thousands of public servants to service our predicament. Understand that. There's a whole army of people under the various government departments that are there to service and kind of perpetuate this structure that we're in. That governments don't care about things Māori has been apparent for some time. And I just quote you from this stuff, that this is a press release when government stopped funding for Kurukapu Māori that I made. This government has no intention of providing educational programs in accord with Māori spiritual, social and cultural aspirations. The recent press release by Honourable Brian Donnelly, Associate Minister, Education Minister, announcing that government is conducting an assessment, this is how they cut funding, the government is conducting an assessment of the way the MOE establishes new kurukaupapa Māori to ensure their success right from day one is absolutely, and I said that is bullshit, it's absolutely ludicrous and dishonest. It's just more lies for Māoris. If this claim had an ounce of truth, then government would have consulted with the national body for these schools, the Runanga for Kurukaupapa Māori, but not a word. This is out-and-out colonial cultural practice at its best. And here we are on the brink of a new century, this was written in 1999, supposing to be an enlightened society. What Mr. Donnelly is saying is simply that government is not going to build any Kaupapa Māori schools this year because it's not a priority. You don't have to tell all that rubbish about we want them to give a good start on day one and day one. Despite numerous submissions, and here's the rub, despite numerous submissions by the Runanga, that's ruining our Mongakura Kapakumahari. By individuals, by kura whānau, for the government to build in the appropriate support systems to supply kura with well-trained teachers, good managers, and good language learning and teaching materials, nothing has been put in place. I myself, continued Chapels, tendered no less than 8 such reports to the Minister of Education on these very issues during the period of 91 to 94. And here's the joke. Most of these were produced on contract to the Ministry of Education to supply them with advice on the needs of Kaupapa Māori schooling. They're in the cupboard with the other stuff. So the Ministry's so-called assessment of the way kura are established is already on the shelf. They're in there. So, you know, to cut a long story short, a quote from Donnelly, he admits to the government inactivity when he says, unfortunately, we haven't planned this part of the exercise well into the past, and this has created a gap between getting sufficient resources to meet the demand for this kind of education. You know what he's saying? The act was passed to make kura bona fide school in 1989. This is 1998. 9 years have passed. There is no policy for kura. There is no new money, the new legislation, no new money. There was no rohemi, no appropriate resources. There was no teacher training program. There was no advocacy. They weren't going around telling kohanga whānau, you can have a kura. They were saying, go to your local school and have a bit of a class. You see, this is the point, isn't it? That we are being babysat by successive governments, not just this government. It's not about Labour. It's about successive governments. National Labour Coalition. They all put us very low on the priority. They do not care about Māori. They are babysitting Māori, and now they are starting an attack to remove Māori. Realise how serious this is. This is serious, serious time. They have deliberately, Brash has said on one side, Dr. Brash, that he's going to stop all Māori-funded, racial-funded, Māori-funded stuff. He sees no distinction between Māori and Chinese, Māori and Samoan, Māori and Polish, none at all. He has no recognition of the concept of tangata whenua and the 1,000 years that we have lived here on these islands. No recognition whatsoever, and Labour is trying to outdo them at the same game. So just know, and they're taking turns at attacking institutions like the Pōhiri, like Rūmaki Reo, like the treaty now. If they take the treaty, we're down the river. We must lie on the railway line for the treaty. We have to do that, and that's why there is a Māori Party, and this is not a campaign speech. If you don't want to support the Māori Party, fine. You stay with your government. But what I'm telling you is, they are very, very strong. They have convinced our very good people that we put in there that they must do as the party says, and except for one. And that's the one that I'm following, and that's why I'm prepared to go in there. And when I'm comfortable at Waititi, I open my window right outside. It's the playground of the kura. All day I hear these kids, kōrero Māori, play up. Ah, damn, I want to die there. Now I've got to just go away for a few years and do something, and then I'll come, but I'll come back. I'll get back to that. So just know that this is what's happening to you. And I was going to quote to you also from a recent government about what they were going to do. It's Labour, what Labour said when they came in, and they haven't done it. So, but I won't go there. But I want to tell you that Kaupapa Māori is not just a list of things. Kaupapa Māori is a way of life. I only saw one bubble of Dr. Elizabeth Rutter's kōrero about kura kaupapa Māori. One rebuttal from a woman at this one. I expected a barrage. Are you kura kaupapa people or not? I mean, are you kaupapa Māori people? Why do you let someone do that? Why do you let someone say that because we are so cultural and spiritual, we're ill-equipped to be scientific? That's basically the nub of what she was saying. And I gave that woman an A-plus for her thesis. No, seriously, because at that time, what she said, she understood. But you see, it's you know, she is not living a Māori life. And that shows you, Kaupapa Māori is not a list of stuff. It is a whole way. The quarter about us being holistic is not just bung bung. It is totally real. And that's the point. She has not identified, if I can use this word, the apodictic truth of our spirituality and our myths and our legends and our religion. And it's co-opposite, the scientific truth, which comes out of that. So Maui didn't do all those things for nothing. The adventures of Maui is like, it epitomizes the what we would like people to achieve. So on the one side, you've got these nice stories. On the other side, you've got the endeavors of us as a people. One to every 180. Obviously, someone's missing. They're in jail. Someone, two people, I would say, by the number of people here. Two people in this room, one from inside this whare, one from outside in the tent, are in jail. Think about it. You probably know them. This is the reality. When one in 180 is in prison, your family knows about the courts. Your family knows about the police. Your family knows about the whole system because one of your family's in prison. And this is the reality. It's not someone out there who's in prison. It's our cousin, our brother, our whatever. So you know. And that's got to change. That has totally got to change. Well, they lock someone up who's a rapist and they let him out in 7 years and they think he's cured. You see, there is absolutely no rehabilitation in the prison. The staff in a prison are door lockers. They are people who keep you in a place and they move you to another place. And there's a lot of these people. They're jailers. In a Kaupapa Māori prison, there'd be one key, the front gate. Everyone else working there would be either a teacher or would be a social worker or a healer or something like that. And everyone in the prison would be on a path to cure themselves. There would be whānau connections set up. The prison would be run by a whānau. Who's the whānau? Three lots. Inmates, prison staff, which are the nurses, the social workers, and the iwi, the local iwi. And you get into that prison and you kaupapa katoa. There's a few golden rules, and if they're broken, the inmates go back to the regular prison. But you'll find they won't be broken. We've tried this on a mini level at Paremorema, we've tried it at Hastings, we've tried it at different places. But no one has been prepared in the Justice Department to accept the whole model. No one. Almost. And then they moved on to another department and became the head of that department, and so we lost them. We had to start again, convincing the next public servant, and so on and so forth. Kaupapa Māori is so relevant. It is our way, and it's the whole way, not bits. And that's why it should be there. We're building a wharewana now at Waini Waititi. And let me tell you why it is different and why it's not up and running now. We've been going, negotiating this for ages. Because we want Māori to own it. Because we want to reclaim Mātauranga Māori as ours. Because we want to validate Mātauranga Māori in this wharewana. It won't be a big one, but it will be authentic. So instead of having a council like the Access, we will stay outside the Education Act. We will have a runanga, and the people on it will be selected by the iwi and the people, Māori people. And they will say, we are. I mean, they didn't go around getting your, making you become a trust board or something when your ancestors signed the treaty. They could, every brown face here, sign here, right? Why should we have to go through an act to prove we are worthy, our word is worthy, of running education programs? So we've been to the hapu, we've been to your tribes, and we've got tautoko for this kind of institution, where they would have a say, where they would have a say in the appointment of one or more of the people on the governing body. And that body would contract to government to run programs. Now listen to this. They would also be validated by the Indians of North America, by the Hawaiians of Hawaii, by the Aborigines Western Australia. And all these institutions were visited and set up the exchange and their totem. Because they are indigenous peoples like we are. And it's about indigenous knowledge, valuing ourselves. That's just the governance. What about the management, the delivery? No Senate. We will have whare. Whare toi. Whare ahureo, mutereo. Whare wānanga, like in the old days. And we have people in this room who would be beautiful people in these whare. So for real, you could have your experts that just come to your mind straight away from that tribe. And they would sit in there and they would validate the language programs. They would validate the teachers. They would validate the examination system and so forth. Why do you have to go to either a Vice Chancellor's Committee, which is how universities validate their programs, a whole lot of pākehā and different institutions put it past them, even Māori programs, tick, 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 come back a year later, you got a program. What kind of validation is that, really? Or, if you're a wāmanga, you go to NZQA and you take a fit off there and say, yeah, we'll run with that. Why should you have to do that when you have the real experts alive? The tōunga or enema. And they only need to meet 3 times a year to validate the teachers and the programs, bang, you're away. So this is something that we're having great difficulty in getting government to get their heads around. But even more so now, there's a downer on everything Māori. But it will happen. So I'm just letting you know how important kaupapa Māori is. So to finally, to finish, I'd like to propose that you might consider gearing your research to include those interventions that work so well in our schools. For health research, it could be located in a theory of kaupapa Māori, that it could contain the elements of authenticity and integrity for Māori, that it is in total accord with the goals of kaupapa Māori, that we can live as Māori, have a future as Māori, with our language and customs intact, that we can look forward to good health in that life. This is an ideal to put into your health research. Health research should not be restricted to repairing or even just healing. Instead, health research for Māori could be about determining a future, about creating exciting possibilities. It could be about health education to make real the options available to Māori, to empower Māori to take control over their own health. For instance, we have an abundance of research connecting cigarette smoking to major illnesses. But where is the research into possible kaupapa Māori measures to decrease the incidence of smoking amongst Māori? Clearly, Māori are not responding to the various social sanctions. We need a measure, if we're serious about this, that Māori will respond to. Kaupapa Māori research. We need kaupapa Māori research to promote kaupapa Māori solutions to community, to communally combat glue ear. If your kid doesn't get glue ear, you feel left out. We need kaupapa Māori initiatives to combat diabetes, asthma. Research to produce strategies to educate Māori to own these illnesses and to combat them as an iwi or whatever. Not go to the doctor for a bad cold and find out you've got pneumonia because you've got diabetes. And then a year later, you die, like happened to one of our elders in West Auckland. Health education can be emancipatory. And I've taken health just as one area, the hardest. Māori research, as with kaupapa Māori in schools, must be emancipatory. It must stand tall in opposition to the negative stigma that applies to Māori health at this time. In schools, the failure syndrome has dominated Māori education. Parents fail, kids fail. Expectations are low, so on and so forth. The Hunt Report of 1960, we're not actually underachieving. TPK Report of 2000, same story. 40 years, no change. Māori health research should be located in future goals. If we want to create healthy habits for Māori diabetics, then locate the programs in a Māori future. Don't try to make our diabetic incident as low as the Pākehā. How depressing. We need to be healthy for our own sake. treating ill health, we need to divorce ourselves from the popular conception that we Maori are sick and sicker than others. I remember having a beautiful hour with Muhammad Ali in his room in the hotel, in the Continental Hotel up in his suite. And this lady who was so shy, and I was meeting her family every week, doing something on it, chasing her kid or getting some stuff for her or whatever, whatever. She's so shy, and she's really, really cool and all that kind of stuff. She idolized me, and I was her champion. So she went on her own initiative, this shy woman, to Muhammad Ali to try and get an appointment for the black champion of New Zealand to meet the black champion of the world. And of course she couldn't get near him. So she thought she'd go really early in the morning. So she went really early in the morning. And she got a bus in from Tauranga to the Intercontinental, and she went into the breakfast room and waited, and he came down. And there was a line on his breakfast table, and they all had photos of him. And they were getting a sign. He was talking away to his people, and he'd sign like this, next, sign like this. And she said, this is her telling me. This is a shiny. She telling me, and when it came to my turn, he went like this. Where is it? For the photo. I said, what did you say? I said, oh, Mr. Ali, I don't have a photo. And he said, oh, well, what do you want? He said, Mr. Ali, you are the black champion of the world, and I want you to meet the black champion of New Zealand, because that was his photo. And he said, no, I'm not here to fight. No, he's like you, he's a good man, he's a champion like you, and I want him to meet you. And you know, she went on an appointment for me for 1 hour, and then she came and told me in my office, but you have to go to Mr. Ali. And I didn't even know he was in town. Eh? So, who's Mr. Ali? Oh, is he the landlord or something? No, Mr. Ali, he's his note. And I had a real scribbly writing, sweet so-and-so. In the hotel. I said, yes, he's in the hotel. He's the champion boxer of the world. I said, you're joking. No, and then she told me about the breakfast trip, and I just couldn't believe it. Well, 3:15, I was up there waiting around the room, and I knocked on the door, and his wife answered the door, and she said, are you the black champion? And I said, I've got an appointment to talk to him. I said, come in, not here, but come and wait over there. So I waited there. And they were running around. There's a whole entourage. You think the champ would like this? Does the champ like this? The champ get his tickets? So I did this. And it was all about the champ. And then I was aware all these 100 people in the suite was opening up into other rooms. Suddenly there was a film. It's different. And there he was, filling the whole door, leaning up against it, watching his team do all the stuff for him, you see. And I just couldn't believe that I was in the same room as this guy. And he walked past me, and he got level with me and says, you're the black champion of this country. And I said, no, oh, yes. Take a seat. There was a table in the corner. I took a seat in the corner, and I waited for him. And I watched him deal to everybody, and he came over, and he says, you're Maori? I said, yeah, Maori. And he asked me about 3 or 4 questions. And the questions he asked me, this man, he just knew where life was at. He was indeed the black champion. Just how he talked on TV, you know this face, you see this face, beautiful, pretty, that's how he talked to me the whole way through. But we were interrupted by the chief of police, who came in with his son to have his photo taken, and he just said, excuse me. So he goes in the corner and stands there, has a photo taken, you're welcome, and off they go. Then came the mayor, I says, I had a photo with the mayor, and then came MP, and he brought his son, and they posed for him in the photo, and the MP goes, hold on, and he put his fist up to Muhammad's face like this, and posed in the photo. Just before they clicked, Muhammad looked at him with such scorn in his eyes. I thought, oh, what a good photo, still kind of look as they clicked. But this was happening while I was in the room, you know, and I just couldn't believe it. He kept coming back to me, talking to me about Maori, New Zealand blacks. Then he goes, he sees two girls And each time they came to him, I went to the corner. I retired to the empty corner of the room, you know, just to let him do his thing, get out of the photo, you know. And the policeman, they knew me. I was race relations. So they knew me. And they went, "Oh, hello." Like, what are you doing here? So anyway, that was fun. That was fun that time. Anyway, I just went to the corner. Then suddenly, he said, "Oh, hello." And I looked at the door. There were two beautiful-looking young Maori women who worked in the hotel, and they had a photo each. And he go, and as soon as I saw them, up to my corner, and he went like this to them. They came over. They almost got to him, and they turned the sharp right, came to my corner, gave me a kiss, went back to him. The second one gave me a kiss, went back to him. And he watched. Took that aside. "Why did you kiss him?" Signing the photo. "Why did you kiss him?" And she went, "Oh, he's Maori." "Okay." "Let's kiss." And then the next one came. I said, "Do you know that Maori?" She signed it. "No." "Okay." And off they went. And he said, "Man, you are so lucky. You people, I've been all over the world. You people have still got it together. They kissed you because you were one of them. Wow, how many big racists go around kissing each other?" And then he went on and told me about Black is Beautiful. "You see this hotel?" I said, "Welcome in, this is your hotel." A lot of rubbish. "This ain't my hotel. I'm paying through the nose for this stuff." "This ain't mine. Don't listen to that junk. But I do own some hotels." And then he went on about his face, how beautiful it was, and they know this face in Russia, they know this face in Mexico, they know this face, and now they know it in New Zealand. This face is a champion face. I am the champion of the world. I am the black champion of the world. Brother. And he was absolutely correct. He championed his blackness. And he says, "Look, you can have it all in New Zealand. You can talk. Amalgamation, integration, degradation, alteration, degradation." "They're all the same, and it doesn't work. Black is beautiful. Black is beautiful. You're beautiful." Oops, sorry, Mike. "Maori is beautiful." He said, "It's not about being tied up this way or that way. It's about being beautiful in yourself." He said, "You know why we call ourselves blacks? Because Negro means, instead of being white, you're black. Black means you're black. There ain't no question about it. You're black. They're white, and you're black. You're not instead of. And that's why we call ourselves black. Don't you be instead of in this country." And that was like being dry cleaned that 1 hour with him. It was amazing. Just floated out of the room like that. Great man who practiced what he preached. And health education should be visionary. Getting back to the topic. That's not what we were talking about. It must have that quality of promising a future and making people feel like they were on the road to somewhere. It must validate Maori knowledge. There's many examples we've talked about of the devaluation of our knowledge from the Tohunga Suppression Act, our knowledge not being accepted by some. We buried our carvings. This custom of Tohunga telling one person and that person, that's because we were excluded from holding one arm. And it wasn't a Maori custom, it was forced on us. So instead of holding one arm, like we can do today, we kept this knowledge secret. Otherwise we would have lost all of the conventions of Mauteia, the conventions of weaving, the conventions of tukutuku, all those things which were outside of the law in 1907. So people, I won't go on any longer. There's still another 2 hours left. I wanted to go right through health and on those various interventions and tell you, but perhaps that's enough. You've got an idea. So how do I end this address? I've talked more about the task at hand in promoting the possibilities for our people rather than just talking about research per se. And this is possibly because I have a rather personal and acute awareness of the crisis that we face as Maori in today's society, based on the situations which I've spent my last 30 years in. So my final message is a little bit difficult to articulate, but here it is. I guess partly because it's an expression of the frustration that I personally feel when I look at how Maori dominate certain illnesses. This was in terms of health. And how there seems to be a proliferation of Maori health or healing organisations, yet we still sort of can't make too much progress in terms of the numbers, the use of professional health, primary health care, and getting messages across health education to people. In my mind, I don't believe the Maori research by Maori in any discipline today, and including health, can or should remain pure or even objective. I like to think that research today, being active action research or applied research, we not only need research, and I've lost the last page, and new solutions, we need the promotion of new initiatives. Again, to move outside of the box, outside of the square. I know there are guidelines for research. Look, man, I went to two Pacific Islands to do my fieldwork for my master's thesis and my PhD. I got first class honours in both, and I broke every bloody rule, guy. You don't have to obey the rules. You do not have to obey the rules. I just about caused a revolution in Tokelau, and then the same thing in the Solomon Islands. By championing the people's rights instead of staying objective. I need you not to be objective. I need you to be totally biased, move outside of your comfort zone, your box and your rules, annoy your supervisor, and the creation of Kura Kaupapa Māori is like, in my mind, applied research or research on the hoof. So finally, to you all, go for it. Create new opportunities, new possibilities for our people. Tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou.